Glory to God. James chapter 1, verse 16 through 18. It says, "Do not err, my beloved brethren. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Of his own will beget he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures." So it says here that every good and gift and every perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights. I like this next part, which says, "With whom there is no variableness, neither shadow of turning." In other words, God's not going to be good today and gone tomorrow. You know, he's not going to be the good God of mercy and grace and compassion, and the next minute he's the God who lays cancer on you and kills your kids and burns your house down. You know, God's a good God. Everybody say, God is good.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And the goodness of God is something that people need to know about at this time of year. I mean, actually all the time, but this is a time they're more open. People are open. They're open to the even with all the junk that the secular humanists and the cosmic humanists and the demon-possessed intellectuals and our colleges are trying to shove down everybody's throat, people are still open. You know, it's kind of like in our society now, you know, you would think that 90% of this country is pro-homosexual because of how it's been shoved down everybody's throat. You go out and do the polls and they're just not. The vast majority of this country does not, they don't want lesbian or gay people teaching their kids in the schools. They don't want them being around their kids. They don't want their kids to be one. Are you here? But you would hear the news media and Hollywood and those things, and you would think, my God, everybody's, well, they're not. It's just that people just don't say, or people who want to be accepted by everyone try to sound like they're open-minded. It's like, well, sure. Of course, when it comes to their own family, they don't want it. You know, so they really don't. It's not that they're racist or prejudiced or homophobic. They are just against perverse lifestyles. Yeah, that's just the way it is. How did I get on that? Yeah, help me out, Brother Bill. No, but people are open. That's what it is. You know. So with all the, you know, the happy holidays, I was in the store today buying something. And somebody said, "Happy holidays." I said, "Merry Christmas." And they said, yeah. You know, I'm just going to just, you got to get bold. And, but people need to know God is good. Jesus came because God is good. Jesus died for our sins because God is good. Jesus was raised from the dead for your justification because God is good. Amen? The goodness of God calls Jesus to come for our redemption. Praise God. Amen? I mean, of course, obviously his goodness is based in his love, but you understand. So, look what Deuteronomy chapter 31 verse 6. Deuteronomy chapter 31 verse 6 says, "All the blessings of Abraham are mine, silver." I don't know why I put that in there. Let's forget Deuteronomy 31:6. Hallelujah. I think it's just the fact that God's always with us here. "Be strong and of good courage. Fear not, neither nor be afraid of them. For the Lord thy God, he it is that doth go with thee. He will not fail thee nor forsake thee." God, that's right. No, God's on our side. God's with us. God, because of his goodness, wants to make sure you win. God wants you to be a winner. Amen. You know, people are upset about Tim Tebow praying after touchdowns or that kind of stuff. You know, if he pulled out his Muslim rug and did that, they wouldn't say a word about it. They wouldn't say, if he, every time he did something, he pulled out his Muslim rug and lay down on it and bowed to Mecca, they would say, "Oh, we're so diverse in the NFL. We're such a diverse league here." They would praise it. Because he bows his head and acknowledges Jesus Christ as Lord and so forth, they get mad. Well, God never leaves us or forsakes us. Amen. Joshua 1:8, there shall not be any man able to stand before thee all the days of their life. As I was with Moses, so shall I be with thee. I will not fail thee nor forsake thee. Samuel 12:22, for the Lord will not forsake his people for his great name's sake, because it has pleased the Lord to make you his people. See, God's good. He's on your side. And David testified of that. In Psalm 37:25, he says, I've been young, now I'm old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor seed begging bread. Hallelujah. Can you say amen to that? No, never. He's never seen a seed forsaken, or the righteous forsaken, or seed begging bread. God's for us. You can always count on this. God is there for you, to put you over and to cause you to win. Amen. Amen. God is not going to pull the rug out from under you to make you fail. That's not his purpose. He doesn't come to you when you're walking according to the word, doing the things that a believer does that are birthed out of a relationship with God, and walk up to you right in the middle of everything just going great and lay something on you just to try to crush you and destroy you. God's good. I say God is good. Psalm 37:28, a few verses down from there. For the Lord loveth judgment and forsaketh not his saints. They are preserved forever, but the seed of the wicked shall be cut off. Hallelujah. Psalm 41:12, fear not thou, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, yea, I will help thee, yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. Thank God. Thank God that he's going to uphold us. He's going to sustain us. His goodness. What did the psalmist say? Surely good. I mean, the 23rd Psalm. People quote the 23rd Psalm. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow thee all the days of thy life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen. Hallelujah. Proverbs 16:24 says, a man that hath friends must show himself friendly. And there is a friend that sticketh closer to the brother. And then Jesus said in John 15:14, you are my friends if you do whatsoever I commanded you. So God is for you. He will not forsake you. He will not fail you. He will not forsake you. I'm glad God won't forsake me. I'm glad that in the midst of trouble, no matter how bad I've been, no matter how rough it's been, if I'll call on him, he will answer me. Amen. That he will preserve me. He will deliver me out of my tribulations, out of my troubles, out of my anguish. Amen. And you're going through a difficult time. God will deliver you because he's good. And he has, you know, I remember the footsteps poem. You know, I was met the Lord and he showed me, I saw a path of life, footsteps in the sand, and noticed that every once in a while it was just one set of footprints. And I asked the Lord, you know, how come when things got difficult, you know, you left me and I had to walk it by myself? He said, son, that wasn't me leaving you, that was I was picked you up and carried you. That's kind of a paraphrase of that footprints thing, you know, that was out a number of years ago that everybody had to have the footprints thing on the crocheted on the wall or whatever. Hallelujah. But the truth of the matter, that is the truth. In the most difficult of times, God doesn't leave you. He doesn't forsake you. Jesus said, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. God is good. He's on your side. Say, he's on my side. Hallelujah. Come on now. Say, he's on my side. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let me add to this. Not only is he good, not only is he on your side, and he never leave you for a second, he's not ticked off with you. He's not angry with you. Amen? Amen. John 3:35 and 36 says, the Father loveth the Son, and hath given all things into his hand. He that believeth on the Son hath everlasting life, and he that believeth not on the Son shall not see life, but the wrath of God abideth on him. On who? He that believeth not. The wrath of God abideth on him. Notice that. the wrath of God abideth on him who does not believe. Romans 1, 16 through 25. For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation. To everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men who hold the truth in unrighteousness. Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them, for God hath showed it unto them. For the invisible things of from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful, and became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man, and to birds, and to four-footed beast, and to creeping things. Wherefore God also gave them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own body between themselves, who changed the truth of God into a lie, and worshipped and served the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Notice that these things happened to those who rejected, who refused, who didn't believe. It did not happen to those who believed. God's not mad with you. Now listen, God can be displeased with you and not be mad with you. Be disappointed with what you do and not be angry with you. I've got three kids. They're older. I've had opportunity in life to have them displease me. I've had opportunity in life for them to disappoint me. And upon occasion, they just tick me off. But I'm a natural father. Hallelujah. But even that doesn't last long. Amen. Even when I get angry, even when they make me mad, and the one that's probably done the most is Nathan, because he just pulls some boneheaded stuff. I mean, you think Nathan's a big guy, he's partially adult. That's about right, partially adult. He's also partially 2 years old. Yeah, we were in some store the other day. He went to the toy aisle. No. Not the big toy aisle, like televisions and DVD players and cameras. The kiddie toy aisle. And found the little Jeep Grand Cherokee or Jeep Wrangler battery powered for kids and tried to get in it. His legs wouldn't fit in each, one leg wouldn't fit in each seat. He couldn't get in it. I said, son, you can't get in it. They didn't have this when I was little. I felt tough. Hallelujah. You know, and he can spin you up just doing some of the bonehead things he does. You know, climbing trees, you know. But I'm a natural father. I don't deal with anger quite like the father deals with it. But my love for my son, even when I get angry with him, it doesn't last long. It's not like I banish him out back for 3 days, put him on a leash and a collar out there. Now, I might put the dog like that. Y'all got a dog? Anybody ever want to kill your dog? Can I get a witness? Can I get a testimony? Nobody ever wanted to kill your dog. Oh yeah. I'm not even going to ask anybody ever did. I know a pastor. The pastor. He told his kids the next time the dog tears the bear skin out from under the mobile home they lived in, he's going to kill it. That dog would. He came home one day. The dog had tore it out again. He dug a hole, put the dog in front of it, and sit and shot it. Kids came home crying. Where's the dog? Where's the dog? I told you. Thank God the Father doesn't deal with us that way. Yeah, praise God. Hallelujah. That dog did not experience mercy or grace. Hallelujah. But aren't you glad God didn't dig a hole and put you in front of it and shoot you? Amen. Because he's good. He loves you. He's not angry with you. You know, Jesus intercedes for, he ever lives to intercede for us. He's praying for you. What's he praying? Stop doing the stupid stuff you're doing. I'm praying for you. Amen. You pull a boneheaded act, he's praying for you. Aren't you glad to know that? But those who rebel against him, they're the ones that face things that you don't want to face. Romans 2. If I almost read the whole chapter, it's going to leave. We'll skip that. Let's go to Romans 5. But God commended his love toward us that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Much more now, then, being justified by his blood, we should be saved from wrath through him. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Thank God for the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. We've been shielded from the wrath of God by the blood. Hallelujah. Oh, thank God for the blood. Can somebody say amen? Amen. God's not angry with you. I know you may have messed up. And here's the thing. You know, now I grew up classical Pentecostal. In a classical Pentecostal denomination, one that started about 1918, somewhere around there is when it formed. One of the early mainline Pentecostal denominations. There's about four or five that came out of that era that were the major ones. Some people don't know the Church of God in Christ was the first, and it was a black Pentecostal denomination, and the whites came and sat at the back, and after, you know, because they loved the move of the Spirit and they loved the Word, but after a while they went to the leaders and said, we need to have our own church. And you understand this, the era we're talking about. Doesn't make it the best thing, but it's the area we're talking about. And that's where the Assemblies of God formed. Those guys went and started the Assemblies of God. Pentecostal holiness came out of the Nazarenes. Nazarenes and the PH Church separated because of the baptism of the Holy Spirit and tongues. Everything else is the same. Church of God came out of that era. Foursquare came out of that era. And those are your major ones. And so I grew up in one of those major mainline denominations, Pentecostal denominations. And we always thought God was mad with us. We always had a thought that, you know, if I messed up, God was just mad with me. God's not mad. God's not angry. He's not breathing out anger and, I mean, blowing smoke out, waiting to barbecue with the nostrils, the breath of his nostrils. God loves you. Jesus came and shed his blood. Oh, thank God for it. Amen. Oh, thank God for it. Hallelujah. But God commended his love toward us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. Now, much more then, being justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. Ephesians 5, 6, and 8 says, let no man deceive you with vain words, for because of these things cometh the wrath of God upon the children of disobedience. Be not partakers with them. For you were sometimes darkness, but now you're light. Walk as children of light. God is looking at you through a prism of love and mercy. You're warned not to be partaker with the children of darkness, because the devil wants you hanging out with them. Because he loves you. He's not angry with you. You're under the blood. He wants to keep you there. He wants to keep you protected. Amen. Hallelujah. 1 Thessalonians 5, down, for God has not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You know your Heavenly Father loves you today more than you can ever fathom. I talked to someone today, and you know, by email, I said, you know, as much as we love you, as much as we are praying for you, the Father loves you more. The Father cares for you more. The comfort of the Father is greater than anything I could ever say or do. His love, the great love wherewith he loved us. Amen. God is love. God loves you. God is good. Remember Jesus was somewhere ministering, and somebody came in and said, good master. And he stopped him. And he said, why callest thou me good? There is none good save God alone. Now, there's kind of a twofold thing there. Number one, he says, if you're calling me good, are you insinuating that I'm God? And only God is good. And this, not only, only God is good, God is only good. James makes a real interesting statement. This messes up some of our old Pentecostal denominational beliefs. We always believe that every trial, testing, temptation, anguish, heartache, difficult time, place, sickness, disease, death, everything we went through, God was trying to teach us something. There's some kind of lesson we're supposed to get. Just something. How many know what I'm talking about? Just some kind of lesson you're supposed to figure out. And I've often wondered, how many people ever learned a lesson? I'm learning to trust in Jesus. Well, I understand trusting. I understand we're supposed to trust the Lord. We trust the Lord when we're going through places and we can't see the other side. We trust Him that He's bringing us out victorious. Amen. We're trusting Him. But, I don't think, getting every kind of disease in the world and saying, well, I trust He knows what He's doing. In other words, they're blaming God for making them sick. Now, I'll trust God to deliver me. I'm not trusting Him that He did it and He has a reason for it. Amen. It's just kind of an awkward, or really a backwards theology, that God's good. God sent Jesus to redeem us. He provided healing for us, but then He turns around and makes us sick to teach us something. And you talk to people and they just never really can't tell you what they learned. I learned to trust the Lord, as they're dying. What did the family learn? I'm mad at God because they took my mama. You need to learn to trust the Lord, son. How am I going to trust somebody that kills my family members? That's why it's so important we teach people that God's good. God's not the one killing your family members. Are you telling me they didn't go to heaven? No. When we talk about death, you understand the Bible doesn't say the Lord took them. It says He receiveth them. He receives the saints. When they come home, He's received. He doesn't take them. He receives them. He wasn't the party killing them, but He is the loving, caring, faithful Father who receives them because Jesus shed His blood for them and they were Christians. So He'll receive them. The devil may have made a mistake in a car, may have done something, crazy, may have been killed by a lunatic. God didn't cause that, but He certainly receives His saints and brings them into His home of heaven. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. They still get the better end of the deal. Amen. Okay. Now, did you know that God has your best interests at heart? Let me say this here. Paul said he was willing to be sacrificed for his nation Israel. Jesus did that, but God doesn't require that. He's not going to kill you to, get your husband to repent and come to the Lord. God has your best interest at heart. He wants you to walk in His blessings, walk in His covenant, walk in the fullness of His plan. There is a plan for your life. God has a plan for your life. Oh, thank God. Sometimes those plans are short-circuited by circumstances and events that are not of the orchestration or design of God. We do live in a fallen world. There is a devil out there. There are people who don't know how to say the right things and speak the right things and keep their life protected. Are y'all here? Amen. Those things are out there. But God wants you to walk in His blessings. God wants you to fulfill your destiny. God wants you to see it through to the end. Hallelujah. And there are people who quit short or just decide they've had enough. I was talking to someone recently and they said, we're talking about their mother at 88 years old. They had gotten remarried older. The mom lived with them for 10 years. They were now older themselves. They got remarried. And the mom, about 2 weeks after the son got remarried, told the new wife, Now, you understand, new wife doesn't mean young wife. In this case, it wasn't. Okay? The new older wife, not older than the man, but older. Well, he's got somebody to take care of him now. I'm ready to go home. And about 3 days after she made that statement, she's in heaven. Praise the Lord. God's good. He's on our side. 88, that's all she wanted. She said she was ready to go home and left. What can you... Well, did they not walk in the blessings of God and fulfill their destiny with all that? They went as far as they wanted to go. And they went home. I'm telling you, I know we have more power over life and death than people realize. And we need to walk in the light of that. But he has our best interest. The heart wants us to walk in the blessings. Romans 4:7 says, saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and sins are covered. The next verse says, blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. Galatians 3:8 says, and the scripture foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, and these shall all nations be blessed. This right here, this foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying that in thee shall all nations be blessed. God foreseeing. My son had a question in his philosophy class, and their philosophy class, schools are Christian based, but you know they kind of take an approach sometimes that we just don't see eye to eye on. There's some sovereignty in there. Everything happens for a reason, kind of stuff, and you know that's okay. Nathan's been, and the girls have been trained well enough. They see it a mile away. But there's a lot of really, really, really good things they teach in this class, particularly about humanism, communism, Marxism, Leninism, Marxism, the worldviews of these things versus Christianity, secular humanism, cosmic humanism, and so forth. These different things, New Age is what they refer to as an emerging worldview. Doesn't have a full-blown one, but it's emerging as one. And so there's so many things there that are just really good that my kids are trained enough. They can throw out they can eat the hay and lead the stubble. You know, Brother Hagin say eat the hay, lead the stubble. People say eat the hay and lead the sticks. Amen. But they were talking in one class, and they kind of got over the sovereign thing and said, well, Nathan kind of jumped in there and said, chimed in there. Well, you know, wouldn't the predestination be based on the foreknowledge that God had? And then he predestined, and they just kind of blew that one out. They just not really blew it out of the water. They just kind of changed subjects, went somewhere else, and left because you know, here he says, foreseeing, for whom he did foreknow, he did predestine to be conformed to the image of his son. He did not predestine them to be conformed to the image of his son. He foreknew they would become, and therefore he predestined them. Predestination is based on the foreknowledge of God. Not on a sovereign choice that Benny goes and Deneen doesn't. It's based on his foreknowledge. In other words, because he looks into time and sees the gospel preached and sees someone accept it, he at that point from back here predestines them to be conformed to the image of his son because he knew they would accept that. He sits in the middle of time and sees all the different, all of time. Hallelujah. Jesus was the Lamb of God slain from the foundation of the world, but it was 4,000 years after the world was created before he showed up. Now, if we're using a literal, you know, 7-day, you know, can I say something? Between Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:2, you can stick all the carbon dating stuff, data you want to in there. Because I believe in the Hebrew word there, that the earth was void without form, can also be, depending on what translation and what what's the word I'm looking for, Bill? Manuscripts you're looking at can also be translated became. It answers a whole lot of questions. If the earth became void without form, amen. And the Bible says, and the earth was void without form. Yet, you go over into the prophets, and I believe it's Ezekiel, It could be Jeremiah. Actually, it's Jeremiah. Jeremiah says this, God makes nothing void and without form. Then how could he have created the earth void and without form in the beginning if he makes nothing that way? He became. Anyway, I don't know why I got off on that. Oh, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith. Preach the before the gospel unto Abraham, saying unto these shall all nations be what? Blessed. So they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. Galatians 9. Then verse 14, that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Hallelujah. I like the way Ephesians opens up in the third verse. It says, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Where? In Christ. Hallelujah. So God wants you to walk in his blessings. God is for you. He wants you to know him in a deeply personal way through Jesus Christ. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to the Father but by me. If you already know him, he wants you to draw closer. If you don't know him, he wants you to be saved. Amen. James 4:8, draw nigh to God, and he'll draw nigh unto you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Some people say a lot of times, you can't get any closer to God. Well, then why did the Bible say, draw nigh to God, and he'll draw nigh to thee? We're talking about in fellowship. We're not talking about in kinship. We're talking about in fellowship, in knowledge, in intimacy. Amen. You're not going to be any more born again than you are right now. But you can be, I can't get any more married to Janie than I am right now. But I can be closer to Janie. She can be closer to me. Amen. But there's not a thing I can do to be any more married than I am. I was married. And the only way to get unmarried is to get divorced. But as far as action or activity, I just, I could go home every day and sit in my lounge, my recliner. Actually, she took my recliner. And I only gave her one day and she took my recliner. She said, it's more comfortable than where I was sitting. I lost my recliner. That's almost sacrilegious to a man to lose his recliner. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Anyway, I can go home and sit on where Janie used to sit every day and never say, I love you. Never say, you're wonderful. Never say, I'm glad I married you. All things I do tell her. Ever again. And I won't be any less married than I am right now. I can walk in every day and say, I love you. You're the greatest thing since peanut butter and sliced bread. There's just nothing. I mean, Nutella doesn't even measure up to you. Anybody ever had Nutella? How many ever had Nutella? How many haven't had Nutella? Go to the grocery store. Get you some Nutella. Hazelnut chocolate spread. Get you filled with the Holy Ghost if you're not, or get you refilled. Hallelujah. We first discovered it in Europe, and then all of a sudden start seeing it showing up over here a few years later. Hallelujah. I could do all kinds of things. And you know what? I won't be any more married. I'll be closer. My drawing closer to her, she'll draw closer to me, but it won't change my marriage relationship. Drawing closer to God won't make you any more a Christian, but it'll make you closer in fellowship and intimacy with God. And he says, if you'll do that, I'll draw closer to you. Amen. We're not talking about legal standing. We're talking about fellowship, spiritual intimacy. We're not talking. You understand the difference? Okay. Janie and I have a marriage certificate. We're married, whether I tell her I love her or not. Now, I can tell you, if I come in about a week and a half and not saying I love you, don't talk to her, don't do anything, we're probably not going to be drawing close together. Probably going to have the Cherokee tribal war dance take place. Hallelujah. I saw that when we first got married. I got to experience it. I don't know if she ever went up to Cherokee and learned it, but it must be naturally inbred because I got to see it. Hallelujah. About 2 weeks after we got married, she put the war dance on me, Brother Benny. Hallelujah. Haven't wanted to see it again, but it was hilarious. That really makes her mad. We don't have these things happen now, but it used to make her so bad. She went off on her little Cherokee war dance, and I just turned my back and laugh. But I'm thinking, you're just a little chihuahua. She's not here to defend herself. She probably won't see this. Just you, little chihuahua. I'm twice your size. Hallelujah. Anyway, I'm just rambling now. But you know what? It didn't make me any less close to God. Our marriage wasn't any less married. Although you could be saying you're angry, I wasn't unmarried. Loving on her and expressing that did not make me more married. Drawing closer to God and him drawing closer to you doesn't make you any less a Christian or more a Christian. It's just your relationship and fellowship's better. Amen? Praise God. So he's on your side. Say, God's good. He's on my side. He's not angry with me. He's for me. He wants me to walk in all the blessings. In Jesus' name, amen.